हेलो, गुड आफ्टरनून। एम आई ऑडिबल?
गुड आफ्टरनून या गुड
ओके,
आफ्टरनून सर।
नॉट एबल टू, आई म्यूटेड माय। हेलो, गुड आफ्टरनून डॉक्टर सुगु, एम आई ऑडिबल?
यस सर, यू आर ऑडिबल सर। गुड आफ्टरनून सर।
सो आई एम ऑल एट योर डिस्पोजल, एंड
यस
व्हेनेवर
सर,
यू वांट मी
थैंक
टू स्पीक आई विल स्पीक। ओके,
श्योर सर, थैंक यू सो मच सर, थैंक यू सो मच।
यस सुगु, प्लीज इंट्रोड्यूस नरहरि सर। थैंक यू सर, फॉर जॉइनिंग।
हाय, गुड आफ्टरनून डॉक्टर प्रॉश, द बॉस ऑफ बायोक्लूज।
अरे नो, इट वाज नो, बॉस, यू आर द प्रेसिडेंट। या थैंक यू सो मच, थैंक यू सो मच सर, फॉर जॉइनिंग इन योर बिजी शेड्यूल्स। थैंक यू सो मच।
प्रश, यू कैन इंट्रोड्यूस नाउ
प्लीज प्लीज।
या गुड इवनिंग वन एंड ऑल। थैंक यू ऑल द पार्टिसिपेंट टू कम ऑन टाइम। आई रियली अप्रिशिएट दैट। नाउ टुडे I take privilege introducing a great personality in Indian bioinformatics, is doyen of bioinformatics in India. I take him extreme privilege to welcome Dr. Narahari Shastri. He is a Shanti Bhatnagar Award awardee and a J.C. Bose Fellow, and is currently the director of NIST Jorhat. And we are extremely proud and happy that he is the president of BioClues, and he has gotten a vast experience in the field of computational chemistry, and is specialized in computational chemistry and CAD. And I take extreme privilege in welcoming you, sir. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much, Sugu, and good afternoon, all of you. And it's first of all, I'm very much thankful for the nice and cordial welcome and remarks, which I don't know whether I deserve or not. And also, I'm very sorry that I was unable to join the day before yesterday. Now, BioClues is entering into Sweet 16. So it started in 2005 and now it is 2021. So it is a prime age for any organism to be at its best or its BioClues. And I feel that it will also go from Sweet 16 to Matured 60 in a way which will impact in a big way about how we can look at the most advanced topics in science. One has to understand that bioinformatics is a subject which has emerged out of necessity, because when you have a subject like biology, where you observe things, how things are happening, and then you try to make some hypothesis or concepts or theories, and all these things will come out of your observations. But when these observations are far too many, which are very difficult for a simple human to comprehend, then we may have to adopt to some mathematical means or some statistical means or some information processing, because you can probably remember 100 people, their names. Can you remember 200? Maybe some people can remember, but how about 1,000? It becomes a challenge. Then, when it comes to 1 million, it's almost impossible. If it comes to some 10 billions, no, there is no way. But if we want to really process all this information and get something out of it, we'll have to do it. That's how the complexity of biology has come to the fore, because we have so many complicated phenomena that are there which we want to understand. So we can go from a reductionist approach, where you can take an organism and you keep on reducing it to smaller and smaller things, and you come to a level of cell, and you will have a eukaryotic and prokaryotic cells, you will have a cell membrane and a nucleus, you have mitochondria, you have transcription and translational processes, and you call it as a central dogma, you have DNA, RNA, mRNA, RNA, you try to understand everything. And then you come to a conclusion that probably if you really sequence all this genome, you might have solved something. So there's a project called a Human Genome Project. But when you solve that, you are having more questions. You may have answered one big question, but that itself has raised to so many different questions. You have a coding region, non-coding region, whether non-coding region is important or not important. There are quite a few things, but if there is a difference between the DNA of two humans, what does it mean? How important it is? So genomics have come and proteomics have come and pharmacogenomics. So it actually, the amount of information that is going is at an exponential pace where the computer science approaches have become absolutely essential for us to comprehend the complexity of the biological processes. So there is a huge area which was covered under bioinformatics, but there is something called computational biology, which is something which is related to bioinformatics. There are so many terms that are there, and there is computational chemistry, where you may have to look at the properties of molecules. But before molecules, if you look at the whole organisms, you can go to the reductionist approach and everything, and you can go to smaller and smaller pieces, and you may go to some simple biomolecules like proteins, then amino acids or nucleic acids. You have purine and pyrimidine base pairs or carbohydrates, lipids. But if you want to really look from a bottom-up type of an approach, you may try to go from an atom, and atomic physics have played a very important role. And then you have molecules, and computational chemistry has played a very important role. Because if you want to really do any experiment, any measurement, you have to conduct an experiment. And when you conduct an experiment, you will have an experimental error. For example, you conduct an experiment to find out the bond length of a particular bond in a molecule. How accurate it is? It is within the experimental error, right? But if this molecule has a certain number of atoms, which is less than a dozen or so, your computational approach will give much more accurate answer than the experimental approach based on the ab initio molecular orbital theory. Not only bond length, but also some reactivity, the spectra of your molecules, because this all started with the hydrogen atom spectra. And in 1985, Professor Henry Schaefer has looked at 125 occasions where there is a discrepancy between theory and experiment, or a computational number and experimental number. And he has demonstrated that in all these cases, experiment has to be corrected, because there is also an error when you are conducting an experiment. So the rigor with which you can subject small molecules to mathematics is very, very high with the advent of computers. Computer power is increasing at a very, very high speed. When I did PhD, we just had these very nice machines, which just are the first generation machines after the job card, because earlier the people used to use the punch card, because all the program has to be written punched in physically in a card, and then the card deck has to be submitted. But when we have this OMC or ICIM mission with the National Informatics Center, if you want to boot a system, you will have to write what is known as a job control language, and the booting process will take about half an hour to 1 hour. And a machine which might occupy a two-story building might run a calculation after 10 hours or 15 hours and you will get a result. And that calculation now you can do with a pocket computer, or even with your mobile phone in about 15 minutes. So this is the way in which the computational power is increasing. So we have computational chemistry. When you are trying to subject this to a larger molecule, this becomes computational biology. So you have what is known as quantum mechanics, which is playing a very active role in giving an accurate description of the structure, function, and properties of the molecules. It is so accurate that sometimes it supersedes the accuracy of the experimental numbers. So, for example, if someone does a mass spectrometric experiment, they take a molecule and then they try to observe what happens to the mass spectroscopic observation where there is a mother peak, there is a base peak, and there are other fragment peaks. So they usually do the experiment for one day, and to understand what is happening, it will take 6 months, and all these 6 months they will have to do computations. So in chemistry, the interplay between experiment and computation has become absolutely essential. And in biology, the interplay between data and observation has become absolutely essential. So when you try to have a reductionist approach, you go to the molecule. So you will have the structure of your nucleic acid. What is the DNA double helical structure? You have a purine and pyrimidine base pairs, and they will have a hydrogen bonding interaction. And somebody will say that, yeah, there is also this stacking interaction, which is important. And you will have this sugar linkers and phosphate backbone. And people are trying to look at the structure in very, very microscopic fashion. And if you look at your DNA, you have a minor groove, you have a major groove, you have an intercalating region. And from there, you will be able to find out which particular region, if some small molecule binds, might have some efficacy in terms of its biological function. So when you try to look at the enzymes, enzymes have a function which are very unique, and then people try to mimic them. So we need to understand how the biomolecular functions are taking place as a function of its structure and its arrangement in three-dimensional space. Okay, so bioinformatics has been evolving like this, where molecular modeling, in which we are working, and people like me who are working in computational chemistry, are also attracted to biomolecules in a big way. Let me take a sub-subject in this, which is drug design. That you would like to design a drug molecule. So whenever you want to do something, you need to have a theory. What is the theory? The theory or the hypothesis is that a small molecule will bind to a receptor and elicits a biological response. So about 100 years before, there was a concept called lock and key. So the key is a small molecule and the lock is a large protein or other biological receptor. And if somehow this small molecule binds to this particular protein, it might have a biological response, right? That was the concept. So people do not know the structure of a lock sometimes, because protein structures were made available only in 60s, because those of you who are doing PhD, they know that about 40 years before, if you have one protein structure solved, that is your PhD. And 50 years before, if you solve one, you will get a Nobel Prize. So many people got Nobel Prize just because they are able to solve a protein structure, which is so difficult, which is a big challenge. But now multiple protein structures can be solved And even in one thesis, there are theses which has a dozen or more protein structures which are there. And then they are doing a lot more experiments in addition to that. So things are changing. So we are trying to understand biology from a reductionist point of view, and computational biology and bioinformatics have come. But there is also another subject which was emerging called systems biology. Systems biology is from a holistic point of view. So there are many different ways of looking at it, because it is very difficult to pinpoint a singular factor for a particular event. So one has to look at systems biology, which is a completely biological way of holistically looking at a biological system. So there is a whole lot of things like, I don't want to really spend a lot of time on that, but one has to see the difference between bioinformatics and systems biology. And there is another subject which has come that is called synthetic biology. Synthetic biology is a completely different way, where it is almost like an engineer trying to do biology. They're trying to bring in all the concepts of engineering, especially electrical engineers, mechanical engineers, all those people will try to set up a biological system with engineering principles. Why everybody has to come and then try to understand the biomolecules? Because this is probably the most fascinating areas, and people have to understand that there is a lot of scope here to work on. I will try to spend 4-5 minutes on BioClues. BioClues is an organization which, as I said, it is entering into its sweet 16, which was started by essentially Dr. Prashant with a group of his friends in 2005. And slowly it is emerging as an organization and doing so many wonderful things. What is the reason why they are doing it? Just because they're excited about doing it. And things have changed quite a lot in 16 years. There are different types of challenges. So if you want to see, why do you do bioinformatics? Maybe one answer may be just it's fun. It's a lot of excitement fundamentally. Or you can say that this can be useful in discovering therapeutics or vaccines, or it can be useful in biotechnology. It will be useful in agriculture. It is useful in many, many areas, and the applications are really a lot. Whenever you would like to understand why a complex system works the way it works, you will have to go to the details of it. And we have an attempt to subject biology to mathematics, which itself is a very, very complex phenomenon, because essentially some subjects are easily amenable to be put into mathematics. Some subjects are difficult to be put into mathematics. Biology is something which is very difficult, but it's very important to be able to put it into mathematics. For example, why biology is difficult? If I wanted to know that some 10 sticks are there, if I wanted to know which stick is longer and which stick is shorter, it's easy to put it into mathematics, right? I can take a scale and then I can measure that this stick is longer and this stick is shorter, and then I can sort it out. But if I wanted to tell that some 10 sweets are given to you, which sweet is tasty and which sweet is not tasty is difficult to answer. It depends on different people. What is the denominator? That is also important. So some people might like rasagulla, and some people might like jalebi rabadi, or some people might like some peda, or whatever it is. It depends on them. And similarly, if I wanted to know some 10 people, who is more handsome or who is more beautiful, it's also a very difficult term to compare. But if you want to really compare two molecules, whether these two molecules are similar or different, how do you measure? This is also very difficult. We have to develop some matrices. And anytime you would like to depict an objective reality, you will have to make approximations. Without approximations, you will not be able to subject any reality to numbers. This is very, very important. So what is the advantage of subjecting it into mathematics or to some, what we can probably call it as a model, is that it will be easy for us to see what is happening. For example, I will try to tell you that you are in a city like Delhi and you get down in airport and then you want to go to a hotel. And this hotel may be 40 kilometers away and then where it is. So how do you do this? Now, this is a silly question for all of you because you have a GPS and then you assume that everybody will have a smartphone and you just put the GPS and then you will go there. But this is only a 4 or 5 years or 10 years thing. When we were young, no GPS, nothing. We used to ask everybody and then people used to go. But for that also, there has to be a map. This map is something which will be able to tell you how to go from one place to another. And then people should be able to know how to read the maps. This is very important because most of us, when we go first time abroad, they don't say anything. Because in India, if you want to go to somebody's place or some hotel, you can keep on asking. So many people, how to go, he will say, go straight, left, right, something like that. But in many other countries, if you go, they will just give you a map and then you take the map and then you follow the instructions and you will reach your destination. So for that, you need to read the map, which is very important. So if you want to understand biology, you also have to understand some techniques which are there. So I just wanted to tell you that if you go to the fundamental level of a biomolecular structure from a reductionist point of view, you may end up with a protein, and protein can have three-dimensional structure or a two-dimensional, or if you further try to see, you will be able to know the amino acid sequence. So there are 20 naturally occurring amino acids when we are studying, but now there are two additional amino acids. There are 22 naturally occurring amino acids, and you will have a primary sequence. And how does that relate to its three-dimensional structure? So this itself is a challenge. So people in chemistry, problems are a little bit less. If they know the structure, they will be able to say that the three-dimensional structure may be, at least we will be able to predict. But in biology, we don't know. There are different types of motifs. And some of them will be like a helix. Somebody will be like a sheet. Somebody will be like a loop. Somebody does not have any structure. So we have to understand what is the relationship between the primary structure and its secondary structure, tertiary structure, and sometimes these structures are available, which we call it as a three-dimensional structure is available as a protein in protein data bank with protein crystallography. And then we will be able to compare the primary structure, secondary structure, and tertiary structures. This itself is a very big challenge. So you say that one primary structure will adopt a particular three-dimensional structure, but what happens to another primary structure which is very similar? So the answer is, if you don't know the experimental structure, you expect that the second structure, if it is very similar, it may also have a similar three-dimensional structure. This is a hypothesis. Is it correct? In most cases, it is correct, but not in all cases. So you will have to develop which particular regions of the one structure is similar to another structure. So you will have a sequence alignments. You have a sequence with one sequence, you can align with another sequence for whose the three-dimensional structure is known. Or sometimes you don't know, so you will have a multiple sequence alignments, and you have different algorithms that were there. And then this has become a very, very important area where people are trying to find out the three-dimensional structures of biomolecules from the primary structures, which is known as comparative protein modeling or homology modeling. And this become very important, but people have realized that this also has lots of limitations. And we can get some information, and there are many other ways to understand the three-dimensional structure. This three-dimensional structure will behave very differently under different physiological conditions. And when a small molecule binds, it might change its orientation in some way. So people try to not only understand the static structure of your biomolecule, but also its dynamic structure. So if I wanted to very rigorously find out what is the structure of a small molecule, I will have to use a method which is based on quantum mechanics. But these quantum mechanical methods are often too prohibitively expensive to apply it onto biomolecules. Because as the number of atoms in a molecule increase, the computational time that is required to optimize these structures will go exponentially. So it will be very difficult for application of quantum mechanics to biomolecules. So if you want to apply a practical method to biomolecules, it should be based on what is known as classical mechanics. What is the difference between quantum mechanics and classical mechanics? Quantum mechanics will explicitly consider the nuclei and electrons and the bonding of these electrons, and it talks about electronic structure. Whereas classical mechanics will consider that the molecules are built from spheres and springs and each atom, and it will not explicitly consider the presence of the electrons. Whereas quantum mechanics will be based on solving Schrodinger wave equation or its variant in some form. There are many, many theories which are based on that. And then you will hear something like ab initio molecular orbital theory or density functional theory and semi-empirical theories. These are all based on quantum mechanics or molecular orbital theories. Whereas you will apply classical mechanics, which is based on the spheres and springs like bond stretching. You will have molecule based on bond length, angle, and torsion, right? So you have a stretching, angle, bending, and the torsion forces that are there. So you can try to get how strong is this bond when it is stretching. These numbers can come from IR spectroscopy or other vibrational spectroscopy. And that's why it is called force fields, which is based on the Morse potential, which is very simple. And in a very naive way, these classical mechanical methods are based on Newton's laws of motion and its variants in some way. But this describes about the static structure. If you want to look at the dynamic structure, you'll have to look at molecular dynamics. Molecular dynamics is a temporal method where you will be able to look at the evolution of the structure of a particular molecule. It may be biomolecule, it may be a small molecule, or it may be a polymer, it doesn't matter. The application will be the same. And it will tell how the molecule will be temporarily evolve, the structure, how it is changing as a function of time. And sometimes you don't want to go in a time space, you just wanted to sample different things. And these are based on Monte Carlo simulations. And there are different other types of simulations that are there. And then it's a very, very interesting field in its own right. So you are able to take the molecules and you can subject them to classical mechanics or quantum mechanics. But if you wanted to find out the difference between a single molecule, because in any realistic system, you don't have a single molecule. You always have a large number of molecules coming together. And usually millions and millions and millions of molecules will be there, and you will take a statistical average of all their properties. So one has to understand the microscopic properties and macroscopic properties. We all know that there are SI units and there are atomic units. If you want to take a molecule and ask what is the temperature of that molecule, a single molecule will not have a temperature. A temperature or entropy or enthalpy, and these are all associated with a group of molecules. So how do you connect these two? You connect these two by employing what is known as statistical mechanics. In statistical mechanics, you don't have a single molecule, you have a large number of molecules, and you will take a Boltzmann distribution of these molecules, where you will try to use some sort of theories, like which is called ensemble, and there are different types of ensembles, and the molecular dynamics will come into picture, so which will connect the microscopic world to macroscopic world. And then you can try to compute all the properties. So to make the long story short, for every experimental observable, there is a corresponding theoretical method. If you want to measure something, some theory is available. But whether it gives a correct answer or not, it depends on what is the level and rigor of the theory that is there. Because these are all based on approximations. What is accurate? The only thing that is accurate is to predict the properties of hydrogen atom. Schrodinger equation can be solved exactly only for hydrogen atom. Anything which is bigger than that, you need to have approximations. This is at the most rigorous level. So this is about subjecting a particular molecule to a mathematical equation based on either quantum mechanics or a classical mechanics or statistical mechanics. And now there are so many methods which are coming, which are called hybrid QM, MM methods or multi-scale simulation. And on top of it, you have to account for solvent, you have to account for temperature, you have to account for counter ion, you have to account for many other things. And things will be a lot more interesting to know these properties. So it's always a challenge to come up with newer algorithms. So this will come in a broader area like computational biology or molecular modeling, which is a more result-oriented science for small molecules. But bioinformatics is also a part of it. Sometimes these two will be very difficult to separate. But people should understand that there are different methods that are there. So bioinformatics is based essentially on how do you get information out of the data. There's a lot of data. You have lots of observations. And what do you make out of these observations? You have to make inferences out of these observations. And then that will lead to concepts. And that will lead to theories. And if these are theories which are verifiable, and if they are right, they will become an established theory. And if there are data which is not supporting the theory, this theory will fail, and another theory will come. Now, the new era of artificial intelligence and machine learning has come. And I know that Dr. Jayaraman has talked, Dr. Jayaraman Valladi has talked about machine learning. It's become very, very important because you have a lot of data, but you have to learn something from this data. This is absolutely important. For example, if you wanted to make a small molecule with a purpose that this small molecule should become a perfume, or this small molecule should become a fertilizer, or this small molecule should become a catalyst, or it should become a drug. What do? You make a molecule. For example, if some molecules somehow by just luck or some earlier observations that this shows a particular property in that direction, you make all the analogs around that, you make structural changes, you make all these changes, and then you keep on doing the performing the experiments to look at the activity or efficiency of that molecule in that particular function. And then you say that this particular molecule is a promising molecule, and then you can try to make it in a larger scale, right? So now to develop this structure function relationships, you need to have the mathematical theories. These are based on regression models. I'm trying to look at quantitative structure activity relationships, but sometimes you will have to learn from the data that comes. You may not have any ab initio type of methods, or you don't have any real theories which has any experimental observation. Only data is there. From this data, you will have to learn. So these are known as data-driven models or machine learning models. If I just wanted to tell you that there is an object which is having an image, and you try to look at this image and then try to find out what object is this. So you can develop an app, and this app will show what is an image, and it will try to compare with so many images that are there in the database. And if this matches with that particular image, it will show that this is a particular image. If you show a teacup, it will show, oh, it's a teacup. If you say it's a cat, it may show that it's a cat. If you show a tiger, if this tiger is not there in your database, maybe a tiger will also be seen as a cat only, because it all depends on what is your database and what is your method and how do you come to a conclusion. Just because there's an algorithm or there's a method and you get a result, it does not mean that it has to be a correct result. So we have the data that is coming up, and I think it's very important for all of you to understand that the topics that are covered, I feel that it is coming from functional genomics, systems genetics, next generation sequencing, which is a very, very important area, and ethics and etiquette for publishing rare diseases, rare genetic disorders is also a very, very important area. And you have something which talks about databases and web servers, and a particular web portal called Galaxy, machine learning, and network biology, and so many things which will give you some skill set to understand the algorithms for this bioinformatics or computational biology or systems biology. And there are also some things which are very specific, like bacterial informatics. And more importantly, in the current context, about viral informatics and cancer genetics. And also in another dimension, about entrepreneurship and industry prototypes. There are large number of areas. So who is a right person to do bioinformatics? What type of a background they should have? Probably it's a very, very complex question to ask or to answer. Somebody from mathematics is the right person, somebody from physics is also a right person, somebody from biology, chemistry, earth sciences can also be working in bioinformatics in their own way. And we also have different types of engineering, different types of medicine, different types of agriculture, agronomy. There are a large number of areas which are emerging. So people are coming up with newer idea, newer areas like microbiota. The role of microbiota is becoming very, very clear. And people are talking about only microbiota in the gut. But microbiota in other places is also becoming very, very important. And now we all know the host pathogen interactions. And then this has given the COVID has really taking our question to the immunity and health in a very big way. Because a couple of years before, there was a Nobel Prize for cancer immunocheckpoint therapy, right? And people were trying to do different types of treatments, whether it's chemotherapy, which has a side effects, radiation also has a side effects. Surgery will not preclude the re-emergence of this cancer, but immunocheckpoint therapy appears to be a better option. So we have these various comorbidities. Bacterial infections is still Mycobacterium tuberculosis, malaria. Although we are talking about COVID, these are also very important. All the infectious diseases, vector-borne diseases. We don't even know whether these cancers are lifestyle diseases or what is the basis for this sometime back. But now there is a huge amount of evidence that is coming up that cancers may be put into lifestyle type of a diseases. And about 100 years before, cancer and diabetes are very, very rare. Now they become much more important. It is almost everybody in their family, they will be having somebody who is living with it. And we also have the usage of these therapeutics, especially antibiotics. And I strongly believe that we are living longer and our human lifespan is higher only because of antibiotics. And for that, it's not only Alexander Fleming's penicillin, it is our own Indian Yellapragada Subbarao who is responsible for the next generation of antibiotics. If we are all living for a longer time, a lot of credit will have to go for him, where the antibiotics play a very important role. But these very antibiotics is wreaking havoc by indiscriminate use of this. The drug resistant mutants have come. These antibiotic, these bacteria which is resistant to these antibiotic drugs are becoming much, much more difficult to tackle. And I feel that BioClues is doing a fantastic job. And I must really congratulate the spirit, enthusiasm, and restlessness of some of the people to tell something or to be involved in teaching bioinformatics for over 2 weeks is an extremely good thing. And I feel that at the end of the day, we should enjoy what we are doing. And I strongly believe that these types of two-week courses should make a lasting impact in somebody's career. Actually, when I was doing PhD, I have attended a course of 28 days, DST-sponsored winter school on statistical mechanics in IIT Bombay in 88. So that was probably one of the best times that I had because we used to work for 14, 15 hours and a lot of topmost theoreticians of the country have come together. And then they used to challenge us And they used to teach us so many things and then give exercises, which we have to solve and then submit the next day. So now that is 88, now it is almost 40 years. I feel that this is one of the best times that we had. And the friends that we have made during that time, we are still friends. There are about 28 or 30 students who were there. PhD, everybody is doing PhD. And many of them are still in the business of doing science, mostly abroad, and some of them are also in India. And I feel that these types of two-week schools are very important, and I hope, but online is definitely not offline, but something is better than nothing. So at this particular point of time, as you could see that I just was talking in a very casual way, and I feel that bioinformatics is an open-ended one, and systems biology and bioinformatics, although they are very similar, computational biology is also similar, but the approaches and their perceptions are slightly different. And once you realize what are the differences, you still have to go, because you cannot really have just a bioinformatics type of an approach to solve a big problem. So systems biology approaches are also very, very important. And I think it's a wonderful thing that the BioClues is doing it. And I will be very happy if anyone has any questions or comments on the talk. So, Prash, can I stop here and then take any questions that they have? Or
yes, sir. Thank you so much. Thank you so much for the wonderful talk, sir. It was scintillating as always. You have been the epitome for bioinformatics and computational chemistry. It's as simply and wonderfully illustrated by you, sir. I'm sure you know there are a good number of questions. So I would like to request all the participants, if you have any questions, please raise your hand and unmute your microphone. There's a wonderful opportunity, for you all, to interact with one of the best bioinformaticists of the world. Yeah, please. Yeah, thank you, sir.
Hello.
Yes.
Sir, hello, sir. Myself, Dr. Ashok. I'm working as a head of the department in Punjab University in the Department of Systems Biology and Bioinformatics. I am always following your research paper. I'm just copying your hypothesis and demonstrating a lot of my students how to do these chem informatics things. So in that sense, you are my guru in that sense. I learned a lot of things from your paper. Thank you very much for that. The question I need to ask you, because I've been teaching for the last 11 years in this department. Sir, I also taking that course of chem informatics. So I was thinking, is there any databases for Indian natural plant products and their structures, especially designed for the molecule which we can use for like pharmacophore modeling, or maybe for the similarity search, QSAR, or maybe we can go for ADMD property predictions. Right now, I didn't see any initiative from CSIR as such, or maybe another organization where we can have a quality database like PubChem, which is publicly available, and we can use this information, like rich information from our traditional Ayurveda, so that they can be competing with all this, what I called as from pharmaceutical mafia, sorry to say. Yeah. So I'm just curious to know if it is there or not. What's your comment on it?
So thank you. I think that's a very good question. There are databases, but they are not publicly, not yet available. The TKDL of CSIR organization, they are creating these databases, and they with a mandate that they will make it available. And even Dr. R.K. Goyal, who is in Punjabi University, Patiala, is very close to, who is also an alumni of your Punjab University, Chandigarh. And he has a small database with the Russian group that he has developed. And many small databases are there, which can be used. And then we also have a database on molecular property diagnostic suit, which we will try to make it available to everybody. Now also you can have a look at it. And currently in East Jorhat, we have taken this up very seriously, the database of phytopharmaceuticals as well as natural products. And definitely we all will have to come together. The PubChem, the one of the great advantages that we had with this bioinformatics community is that this EMBL and all these organizations have come together, and whatever general software or the databases that they have, they gave it, they disseminated it freely. So that very act has helped them to make these databases stronger. And your question, Dr. Ashok, it's very important that we had several meetings under the, when Dr. Vijay Raghavan was the deputy secretary with the EMBL, and somehow things are a little bit slow. We will have to come together and then make these databases. And Dr. GPS Raghava and Dr. Debashish Mohanty in NII, Dr. GPS Raghava also had several databases that are there. There are people who are having their own databases. So the only way to make something which is competitive with PubChem is that it should be like a community exercise. And we are starting in Jorhat. I started in IICT, and it takes time. We are developing a disease-specific web portal called Molecular Property Diagnostic Suite, where we will have a compound library wherein all the natural products will be available. And I just also wanted to tell that one concept is that every molecule is like a human being. This is our concept. So we would like to give Aadhaar card for a molecule. Maybe somebody who attends my lectures, I usually give this term, Aadhaar card for the, we are in the process of generating the Aadhaar cards and census for all the molecules. And the first guys to get the validated Aadhaar card will be these natural products and phytopharmaceuticals. And I'm pretty sure that by the end of this year, we will make it available in some form. And we request your help and cooperation also to augment it.
We are always there, sir. We are always there. So if you can allow me ask you a short question, this is extension to the same question. If I can allow by Pash. Pash, can I start the short question maybe?
Yeah, please. Yeah.
Hello. So reason for asking this, sir, when I was doing my PhD, so we have worked on one of the molecule called fenbendazole. This is an anti-helminthic drug. And I was very excited. I joined as a young PhD scholar. I worked like anything for 6 to 7 years. My boss used to say that this is a very promising molecule. And if you want to solve this anti-cancer property, then you'll be really solving the problem of this low-cost anti-cancer molecule, something like that. In a way, after 6 to 7 years, we got this molecule verified. Animal studies were also done. I did Eudomyces studies also done. It is published, well appreciated throughout the world. Like, but now I am thinking these are drug repurposing studies. Mm-hmm. When we want to apply for any clinical trial, nobody is thinking of funding me for that clinical trial. So they are saying this molecule is already there. This 1 gram is 20 rupees, which is much more at any capacity of inhibiting the metastatic tumor 70%. I have shown them in the Eudomyces model when I worked with the ATRACT in Mumbai. So I myself developed this molecule. So my question was there, how to do or how to support these drug repurposing like molecules. And what is the reason of this anti-helminthic drug, which is, in a way, these are very safe and non-toxic. And they're very effective against these tumors. We have seen in the lung cancer and we have seen in the prostate cancer. So can you comment what is the reason in chemistry point of view, why they are so effective and still people are not using as an anti-cancer molecule and not getting forwarded? So that is why, because I'm not belong to the chemistry thing, that's why I'm interested.
So basically, okay, the drug repurposing, we will not have much of an issue to start with the development process, but the dosage, the phase two clinical trials have to start. And for that, a lot of money is required. Essentially, the minimum we are talking about anything between 100 to 200 crores. And who will invest on whose molecule? So even if it is drug repurposing, you need to have a cohort and you know that drug discovery and drug development process, right? And for that, you have to have an investigational new drug application has to be given and the corresponding thing with our DGCA. And then we will have to start our clinical trials. And this is a very expensive affair. And we as a country is unable to take care. Even some of the private companies which were doing, they were not able to take it forward. So the clarity of thought process in pharmacology is not very high, because it is the money which decides whether you will get a drug or not. To get a NDA, new drug application, lots of patent, clinical trials, and other things were there. For example, you start with chemistry, biology, design, and other things will be there. Then all of us have to go to pharmacology. And then ADMET properties, PKPD, and everything will be there. Then you will have the preclinical will be cleared. That itself will take some amount of money. And afterwards, when you have a real clinical trials, we don't have this type of an ecosystem in our country, except in some places. Now, the fast-paced drug repurposing is being done in some cases, but it all boils down to who will fund these studies. These are important issues.
A few questions from students and workshop participants, we will allow for 2-3 minutes. Please, sir. Young participants, please ask some questions. Good afternoon, sir. Yeah. Please, we would like at least one or two questions from participants, young participants. Yeah. Okay. I think if we have some questions, you can even email us and then we will send it to Professor NS, sir. So I have one last question, Dr. NS. Yeah. See, nowadays, a lot of molecular papers have come which use directly the molecular dynamic trajectories along with machine learning for predicting inhibitors. Mm. Yeah. You have come across some work and I think it requires a lot of computational power to do that. And any comments on that, sir? Yeah.
Actually, these molecular dynamics studies, where it runs to more than 500 nanosecond, people are doing even a microsecond or even millisecond simulation. So the number of data points that one can get is huge. So this data, if you want to get some information out of that, you'll have to again use some machine learning type of approaches. Because we would like to simple RMST or RMSF will give you some idea. But a lot more structural information is contained in these molecular dynamics trajectories. To get that, a machine learning approach, which is able to process a lot of information in a much more systematic way and get the real features out of that, is essential. And as you know, that you yourself have been working on it. And there is one Dr. Deva Priya Kumar from IIIT Hyderabad has very elegantly shown how you integrate molecular dynamics and machine learning to get good information. Actually, in the last 2 years, he published 5-6 papers in these lines. So from India, but there are a number of groups around the world who are using this. And this is absolutely, machine learning is absolutely essential, whether you are doing molecular dynamic simulations or whether you are getting the database design or mining data from the database.
Thank you very much, Professor Sastry, for a very excellent overview and a lucid exposition of the talk, and it will be very beneficial to the young generation of people who have registered for the workshop. We would again be very happy to have you at all of our future workshops. Thanks a lot, sir. Yeah.
Thank you very much. Thanks a lot. It was such a pleasure.
So thank you very much, sir. So friends, it's time enough to give a big round of applause to Narahari sir for his wonderful talk. So please unmute your microphone and give a thumping applause.